In theology, homiletics is the art of preaching. Hermeneutics is the science of preaching. Apologetics is the proof of preaching. But an outpouring of the Holy Ghost is a result of preaching. Somewhere, if God doesn't move, all your preaching's in vain, and you're just spitting in the wind. Hallelujah. God wants to do something for us tonight. I said, God wants to do something for us tonight. He wants us so badly that He was the bread of life, but He became hungry. He was the water of life, and He became thirsty. He was the world's only rest, and He became weary. He redeemed all of humanity because He allowed Himself to be sold. He was a light, but He hung in darkness. They called Him a devil, but He overcome Satan. He didn't have any place to lay His head, and He owned the golden cattle on 1,000 hills. That's how badly He wanted us to have a service tonight where He could come in and do what He wanted to do in our service. The Holy Ghost is looking for an orifice tonight, a place where He can penetrate and flow in. I was preaching one night in Stockton, California. Brother Kenneth Haney, our current general superintendent. I started off the platform, and I come down the steps, and meet me on the steps was a Spanish guy. And the Spanish guy said, I want to talk to you. Had tattoos all over his neck and all over his hands and arms. And I was trying to find something in Spanish to say that would kind of, he looked mad. I said, taco burrito, man, hallelujah. And he said, I came to kill you tonight. And he opened up his coat and had a .357 Magnum hanging under his coat. He said, I've got hollow point in these shells. When they hit, they open up and spread inside your body when they hit you. And I said, I appreciate that testimony, hallelujah. And I said, why have you come? He said, I came to kill you tonight. That wasn't real funny because 4 weeks prior to that, they had shot and killed a girl on the steps of that church that the gang members had. And I said, why would you want to kill me? I didn't understand you wanted to kill Jeff Arnold or Irvin Baxter, but I can't understand you wanting to kill me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. And he said, the girl I've lived with for 3 years got the Holy Ghost last week and run me off. I like it, don't you? He said, 3 of my mules, that's people that carry drugs for me, prayed through in a revival last week, and I don't have anybody to deliver drugs. And I come to kill you. I said, well, here I am. He said, every time I'd reach for my gun, there'd be a tall, bright man over 8 foot tall would come and stand between me and you and hold his hands out. Hallelujah. And he said, instead of killing you, I got the Holy Ghost tonight, and I want to hug your neck. Hallelujah. Praise God. Boy, I'd a lot rather hug than get shot. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is so awesome. If you ever feel Him, you'll never be happy until you feel Him again. If you ever hear Him, you'll never be happy until you hear Him again. If you ever touch Him, you'll never be happy until you touch Him again. If you're ever in His presence, you'll never be happy until you're in His presence again. And I got news for you, folks. You can come to church and not get in His presence. Come on, you come to church and not get in His presence. You come there and park and saying, I shall not be moved, and mean it. They couldn't move you with a stick of dynamite. Come on, but God wants us to get in His presence tonight. He's pushed. He's prodded. He's done everything He can to get us in His presence. And now we've worked into a little bit of His presence, and God wants to do something for us. Hallelujah. To think what a privilege it is that I know the name of God. Think about that. I know a name that Abraham didn't know. Abraham knew Him as Ehyeh Asher Ehyeh, which means I am what I am, or I will become what I will become. And He knew Him as Yahweh Yirah. Hallelujah. They didn't know Him as a name I know. Hallelujah. Back in the late 70s, early 80s, I was talking to the old rabbi at the Wailing Wall, Rabbi Yehuda Getz, and I was talking to the rabbi. And I said, Rabbi, I said, I know the name that the priest would say when he'd go into the Kodesh HaKodeshim, one time a year, the Holy of Holies. He said, you don't know that name. I said, I know that name, Rabbi. Hallelujah. He said, no, the one priest, as a dying high priest would die, he'd whisper to the ear of his son, and they could never say that name. I said, I know that name. I said, it's Yahweh Yeshua. He said, don't say that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then I said, I said, you know the prayer language? He said, prayer language. And I said, yes, you know, at Yom Kippur, when the Kohen Gadol, the great high priest, would go in the presence of God, I said, the rabbi, the priest, would begin to speak in another tongue that only he and God knew. It's called the God language. That priest would get in the presence of God and speak in an unknown tongue. And I said, I've got that God language. I talk in tongues. Hallelujah. 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 Boy, it's so awesome to know him. I said, it's so awesome to know him. Thank you very much for letting us come. Hallelujah. Sister Baxter has been so nice, anything I needed, every day she'd say, you need anything? And one day I needed some bananas. When I walk, if I eat bananas, it keeps my legs from bothering me. And she said, that's potassium. And I said, yeah, but the only thing, when I walk under a limb, I won't jump up and grab it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's been so nice, and thank you for giving. Thank you for the offerings. And it's always a funny time for an evangelist. If you look around, they think you're seeing who's putting in. If you bow your head, you think you're praying for more, so you never know really what to do. We love you. If you'll stand for the reading of God's Word, we'll just get our swords out and wade into the arena and get bloody. You want to? Hallelujah. Acts 11 chapter. Sound men's done a tremendous job. Sound men's done an awesome job. The music, hallelujah. Praise God. These guys have done well. They haven't done anything, but they do nothing better than about anybody I know. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And old Goober, boy, he can sing, can't he, man? He can put him down. Hallelujah. Acts 11th chapter, the 21st verse. God's not against his people having a good time. He's against it when it becomes hurtful or it becomes unholy, then God's against it. But God wants his people to have a good time. I don't know where we got this deal you get saved and, boy, when I was in the world, man, I had nice clothes and nice car and I had babes and I had a lot of fun than I got in church. I had more fun in church than I ever did in the world. Come on, the first time I ever rolled up a doobie in a zigzag paper. Hallelujah. I was trying to find what I got right now. Hallelujah. Come on. First time I ever got some dope in a spoon and broke it down where I could get it up in a needle and shot up. I was trying to find what I got right now. Come on. Come on. First time I ever slept out I used to sleep out in the graveyard in the 60s and sit out there and hum. Trying to get a hold of spirits. Hallelujah. And they was a hold of me and I didn't know it. I was trying to find what I got right now. Hallelujah. First day I ever climbed on a Harley-Davidson motorcycle and I was trying to find what I got right now. There's no high like the Most High. Hallelujah. Praise God. When you're there, say, here we are, Brother Mahaney. And the hand of the Lord was with them. And a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings of these things came unto the ears of the church which is in Jerusalem. Now, how in the world could a church have ears? We're the church. The people's the church, not buildings and organizations. And they sent forth Barnabas, his name means a son of consolation, a man of consolation, that he should go as far as Antioch. And when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all that they, with purpose of heart, they would cleave unto the Lord. For he was a good man. Everybody say a good man. Full of the Holy Ghost. Say the Holy Ghost was talking to him. And faith. And much people was added unto the Lord. Then watch. He's full of the Holy Ghost. Apparently the Holy Ghost told him to do this. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves together with the church and taught much people, and the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. And I want to preach a little while tonight on Christians first. Christians first. You may be seated. God bless you all. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. If you'll help me, we'll just get this thing over with and get out of here. If you don't, man, I'm like the bishop here. We'll just tug. We'll be able to sing a song for 45 minutes. I was ready to shout to get him off that song. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. See, I'm Christian by my birth. I'm apostolic by my doctrine. And I'm Pentecostal by my experience. Come on, I spoke in tongues as the Spirit of God gave the utterance. Nobody rattled my chin around, told me to say yabba dabba doo or buy a Kawasaki, sell them a Honda. God came down and took my tongue and I spoke in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave the utterance. Hallelujah. Come on, I'm one of them tongue talkers. There's some things you're not going to change me in. And number one is when you get the Holy Ghost, you're going to speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave the utterance. I heard a man's wife one night say, I had the Holy Ghost 7 years and didn't even know it. I said, let me tell you something, Mama. When you get what I got, you're going to know it. I knew when I got the Holy Ghost. I can take you to the place. I can show you where I was standing. Come on. God got a hold of my hands and my feet and my heart, and I spoke in other tongues as the Spirit gave me utterance. I'm Pentecost by experience. I'm apostolic in doctrine. I preach the same thing the apostles preached. If we was to have a baptismal service here tonight, and the Apostle Paul or Peter would walk in and watch this preacher baptize the candidate, he would say, that's the way I baptized in the second chapter of the book of Acts. I was in the Vatican one year, and the Catholic priest was taking us through. And the Catholic priest made the statement, when the river, which was about 2 miles from the Mamertine prison, would flood, the Mamertine prison's Paul's cell would get about waist deep in water, and that's when Paul would baptize his candidates when the river backed up and the water was about waist deep. I said, let me ask you a question, sir. I wasn't going to call him Father. I only got one Father, and he didn't wear his collar around backwards. He said, what? I said, why did Paul wait till the water got waist deep to baptize? Why did he just get a cut and throw on those cats? Hallelujah. He said, because in antiquity, they all submerged. Come on, one of our preachers was preaching in one of them sprinkling churches one night, and he picked up a cup of water and drank it, and the pastor said, my God, man, you just drank the baptistry. Hallelujah. And I said, what? I said, okay, we're back in antiquity. Suppose we got in some kind of time warp or a quantum leap, if you would. Hallelujah. And we could see one of the apostles baptizing. What would they say? He said, well, it was an ancient formula that's not even relevant to today. This was one of the Catholic priests from the Vatican. And I said, what would he say is relevant to me? He said, he would say, I baptize you into the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he would immerse him. But he said, we don't do that anymore because the mother changed it. And I said, that's why we've stayed with the Father. Hallelujah. Come on. I'm apostolic in doctrine. I'm Pentecostal in spirits. I'm apostolic in doctrine. I believe in one God. Hallelujah. I believe you come out of the world comes out of you. I believe you look different, walk different, act different. But you know what? By birth, I'm a Christian. And we've got to be Christians first. Come on. I'm not talking about a Christian in name. I'm talking about a Christian in our relationship to each other. You've never been chewed out until you've been chewed out from some old gal just sung Sunday night in the apostolic choir. Hallelujah. Come on. We Pentecostals don't gossip, we share. And it's easy for the tongue to slip because it's in a real wet place. We're Christians. And there's an interesting play. I believe when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, I believe he was fulfilling Isaiah 11, verse 1 and 2. Said, there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of might, and the Spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of the Lord. I believe Jesus fulfilled that when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. I believe he was the branch, the root that came out of the stem of Jesse. I believe he was the tribe of Judah, that root, that branch. And there's an interesting play on the word Christian. If we was in Israel today and somebody would ask me what I am, whether I'm Jewish, whether I'm Christian, or whether I'm Muslim, God forbid, hallelujah. Come on. I'd say, I need no three. I'm a Christian. And that comes from the Hebrew word branch. Hallelujah. That means we're like him. You see, he was born in Nazareth, which means a shoot out of the dry ground. Hallelujah. He was born in Bethlehem, the house of bread, raised in Nazareth, a shoot out of dry ground. He was in the oven in his trial and tribulation. Hallelujah. But when they planted him, he was the seed, and the seed sprouted up and became the branch, and we're like him. Well, I read something the other day, and it was so awesome. I was on a plane. I said, God, if you don't quit messing with me, I'm going to be up shouting on this airplane. He said, well, I wouldn't do that. That's why God was showing me. He knew you wouldn't respond to it. He wants somebody that's a little bit meshuggah. He wants somebody a little bit crazy that'll respond to when he shows something. Come on. And God got to showing me that I just read a little deal from a book I was reading by Flavius Josephus, the Jewish historian that was contemporary with the apostles, and he said that they brought all the sheep into the sheep market. They would bring literally thousands of sheep into the sheep market, and all of a sudden they'd go into this swirl of sheep, and nobody could figure out whose sheep they was. But he said before they went into the sheep market, they took a little tag and tagged the ear of that sheep, hallelujah, hallelujah, with the family name. Come on, I'm glad one day I got tagged with the family name. Hallelujah. They didn't punch its ear. They tied it around its ear because if it had a punch in it, it couldn't have been the sacrifice. And then when Jesus hung on the cross, you know what got those rabbis and those priests so upset? They walked out that day and they put on the superscription, Yeshua HaNasra'im V'melech HaYudim. Jesus, the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. And you read Hebrew from the right to the left, and it was YHVH they saw on that cross, the name of the Almighty God. And they said, take that down. And they said, I'm not going to take it down. I want you to know that God went through a lot so we could be Christians. Hallelujah. Come on, I said, God went through a lot so we could be Christians. See, there's two words for ruler. I might not be as popular when I get through here as I was a minute ago when I was getting introduced. There's two words for ruler in the Hebrew. One means to lord it over. That's what the Pharisees operated under. The other means where you become the rule, where your life becomes a rule that people can look at and say, I want to measure my life like you. Come on. We need to become the rule. They need to see our life and see the love is the measure of our life. Not religion, not rules, not 613 tallits and mitzvahs that we keep daily, not keeping kosher, but God looks at love. Love has got to motivate it, because if it don't motivate it, it doesn't mean anything. Love's got to motivate our worship. Love's got to motivate our giving. Love's got to motivate our singing. The reason I sing is not to entertain. I sing because I love him. The reason I preach is not because I want to impress you with my theology. I'm up here because I love him enough to leave home to feed his lambs. Hallelujah. I read something the other day that blew my mind. It was about this 11th chapter of the book of Acts. And it said they were called Christians first at Antioch. The Antioch church became the stereotype. It became the pattern for the New Testament churches. Up to that point, it had been a little Zionist mom-and-pop operation. And you get aggravated if you want to, but you're looking at somebody that's a Zionist. I believe God promised that land to Israel, and I don't believe Yasser Arafat or any other kind of fat. He said he's going to march on Jerusalem. When he does, those Jews are going to change his name from Yasser to Noser. I sat and looked that Jewish baby killer in the face, hallelujah, and I never felt such a demon spirit in my life. And they said, don't say anything Hebrew to him. And we walked up, he's about that tall, little bitty, weasley looking weenie. He walked up to me and he said, glad to have you. Told Bishop Urshan, he said, I'm a Christian. And he said, I'm a Jew. Hallelujah. And when he wrote the Palestinian Charter, the Palestinians supported the Nazis because every Jew that was killed in the gas chambers, they wouldn't have to worry about them immigrating to Israel and whipping them and throwing them out. That land belongs to Israel. Come on, that land belongs to Israel. That land belongs to Israel. And the only way you can ever be lined up with God and be right with God is you got to love that root. That root is our root. Hallelujah. Come on, we're a branch by our experience, but we're rooted in the ground of Israel where our Hebrew roots are deep. And one of them asked me, he said, what should we have done? I said, you messed up in 1967 when you took the land back. They said, what should we have done? I should have, when they took that green line down and Israel took that Temple Mount, they should have loaded every one of them in cattle trucks and put them out of the Holy Land. Hallelujah. He said, if you don't, they're going to be thorns in your side, bricks in their eye. That's what it says, ain't it, Bishop? Hallelujah. Come on, see, there's some things we got to deal with. There's some things we got to get away from us. If we don't take care of them, they may become thorns in our eye and pricks in our side. We've got to deal with some things. It's time to quit weeping over Samuel. It's time to quit crying over yesterday. It's time to get up and take our promised land and have the revival that God has been promising Richmond, Indiana for 30 years. The Holy Spirit came on Mary, and Mary said, you know, God talks to us about nations in us when we're not even pregnant. Come on. You're going to have a child. I can see Mary say, oy, hallelujah, am I going to have a child already? I don't know a man. How's this going to happen? And the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you. And when the Holy Ghost comes on you, it always leaves you expecting. Hallelujah. Come on. The Holy Ghost doesn't come upon you and leave you where you was at. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you, it leaves you expecting. Come on, hallelujah. And we ought to be expecting. Come on, we don't know what the baby's going to look like. And I got news for you. If you didn't want the baby, why in the name of God did you buy this nursery to put the baby in after it's born? You could have stayed down there on whatever, A Street, whatever it was, and had a little family deal, a little clique. But God moved you here to have the baby. Hallelujah. This church could triple. This church could triple right now. And still this building would take care of it. Come on. I wish God would fill this thing up and you'd have to have three services on Saturday. Come on. It's ours. It's ours. It's ours. You know, prayers never died. The prayers that our elders have prayed are still alive. The prayers that your parents prayed for this church right here are still alive. And once in a while, God gets them out and releases them. They come up before His throne. Hallelujah. Boy, the greatest thing I can do is pray. Come on. The Holy Spirit comes on you and leaves you expecting. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's no air of expectancy among us anymore. We come, we go through our little program, and the choir sings well, the preacher preaches well, and we've got every T crossed and every I dotted and everything just right. There's no expectancy. I want the intruder to come in and just kick our program apart. Hallelujah. I'm ready for God to come in here and knock over the flowers. Hallelujah. I'm ready for the pulsating power of God to come in here and get a hold of us and mama shout their hair down. Come on. I'm ready for God to get a hold of us because God's ready to do something for His church. Now listen. I was reading the Nature Commentary. I was able to get a page out of it, and that's all I could get. They quit printing the commentary over 100 years old, 100 years ago. And it said the reason the Holy Spirit spoke to Barnabas and said, go get Paul, was because God was testing the spirit of that church before he'd released the revival on them. See, everything God puts you through, God's testing your spirit to see if you can handle it. Why have babies if we're not going to love them? Come on. Come on. It ain't hard for me to love my grandkids. It's hard for me to love yours, and they go crawling all over me with nasty diapers and, come on, just potted and climbing up over me. You ever had them do that to you? Come on. See, God was testing their spirit. God said, I'm going to make Antioch the revival church, but I'm going to check your spirit out first. And how I'm going to check your spirit out is Barnabas, the son of consolation. I want you to go find Saul of Tarsus and bring him back to Antioch. Now, in history, it says that Paul was making widows and orphans out of the people around Jerusalem, between Jerusalem and Damascus. And they took those widows and orphans, and they had a mandate from God to take care of the widows. Come on. The Greeks and the Jews were always arguing about who's going to take care of the widows. Hallelujah. So they took care of the widows that Paul had made. And then when a famine came to Jerusalem, according to history, they took those widows and orphans and moved them to Antioch so they could be taken care of. So God speaks to Barnabas, and so go get Paul. I want to check their spirit and see if they got the right spirit to have it, if there's a spirit of forgiveness. Hallelujah. Can you imagine mama getting the kids ready for church tonight? Say, come on, honey. We're going to go hear the preacher preach tonight that killed your daddy. Come on. You can't even worship if somebody parks in your place. Or sits in your pew. Who said that was your pew? I don't remember voting on you to have a pew in this deal. Hallelujah. Come on. And that's the first place they called them Christians. That's where they prayed and sent Paul and Barnabas out. That's where they brought their money and laid it at Paul's feet, the man that had killed their father. See, it takes something to be a Christian. This little old grudge holding. Come on. Well, I'm not going to speak to her. Hallelujah. She had a dress on like mine. She sang my song. Come on. See, when you get born again, there's a change in your nature. It's not my nature to go around telling men I love them. I love you guys. But it goes against my nature to look at you, McFarland, and say, I love you. When I was in the world, I had to fight to prove I wasn't a lover of men. If you know where I'm coming from. One of the hardest deals I had when I came to the Pentecostal church and guys tried to hug me. I said, whoa. Ain't no guy's going to hug me, man. Hallelujah. But there's a metamorphosis takes place. There's a change in your nature. I love to be with my brethren. Come on. Come on. I love to be with my brethren. And love is not an emotion. Love's a choice. I choose to love people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. I used to be able to get mean when I was in the world. Somebody said, I can't imagine you ever being mean, Brother Mahaney. But I choose to love. Because without love, it's all sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. Without love, all it is just entertainment. Without love, all it is just a meager expostulation of spit and polish. But when we work love into it, hallelujah. Remember Malchus that fell out of the third, or Eutychus that fell out and broke his neck, Paul fell on him. You ever seen anybody fall out of a third floor window? I have. They fell out of my building all the time when I was growing up. Hallelujah. And Paul just fell on him and put his arms around him, loved him back to life. We need some people that can love this world back to life. Our world has fallen. Come on, we don't need a church that'll set up and judge everybody. Come on, we don't need a church that'll set up and judge everybody. Well, look the way she's dressed. Look what he's done. Look what you would have done. There's nobody here. You know the greatest thing God ever... I was praising God the other day. I said, God, I thank you. You saved me from alcohol. I thank you. You saved me from drugs. I thank you. You saved me from all the things you saved me from, rotting in prison and dying with a cop's bullet in my brain. And I thank you. And you know what God spoke to me? God said, the greatest thing I ever saved you from is I saved you from you. He said, the greatest thing I ever saved you from, I saved you from you, what you could do is about yourself. See, when they brought Jesus before the Sanhedrin, they said, tell us about your disciples and your doctrine. If they can't see Christianity in us, and they can't see Jesus in us, you can bark about doctrine all you want to, but there's a closed door because they can't see the love of God in us. Come on, hallelujah. Come on, they can't see the love of God in us. Hallelujah. They can't see the love of God in us. Hallelujah. See, David and Jonathan were in a covenant together. And David and Jonathan in the Old Testament was a picture of what Christians should be walking together. David was a little hillbilly kid. Come on. He smelled like campfire and sheep dip and wild honey and hallelujah. Had a little shepherd's tunic. Had a little nappy hair. I got to work with my hair. It gets nappy if I don't. Hallelujah. Little hook nose, oil dripping off of it, and God give him Jonathan. Every Christian needs to find a Jonathan in their life to walk with and share with. David didn't know who to bow to or when to bow or how to bow or how many times to bow. But Jonathan said, I'm willing to be your guide. I want to show you. I want to love you. I want to teach you. Hallelujah. Hey, don't say amen now because you're not supposed to say amen. Now, wait a minute. Okay, now say amen. Hallelujah. Don't shout. Now everybody's crying. Okay, now everybody, now it's time to shout. You need to line up with the way the move of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And they exchanged belts. That meant if they get through you, they're going to have to come through me. We need that spirit among us. I mean, you're not going to jump on my brother because that's my brother. We're not saying they're right. We're just saying, I'm going to defend him. I'm going to protect him. And then they put their mantle over him. Come here, Goober, up here a minute. Hallelujah. They put their mantle over him. Hallelujah. Hold this microphone over a minute there, Leroy. Hallelujah. David and Jonathan. Put it on. Feels funny to wear a man's coat, don't it? Hallelujah. You know what? When you're in the... Anybody here ever in the military? Anybody here was ever in the military? That's a frightening thought. Hallelujah. But when you salute a man, you don't salute the man. You salute the uniform, that insignia. Come on. And David and Jonathan exchanged mantles. That meant everywhere David went, he had the mantle of the Prince of Israel on him. Come on. Hallelujah. And when they saw David coming, they knew he was coming under the authority of the Prince of Israel. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on. David was a little ruddy hillbilly boy, didn't know how to act, but he had Jonathan. Hallelujah. Come on, you new when the new converts come, they don't need critics to get up here and say you don't know when to lift your hands or how to shout or you're not living right. You know what they need? They need a Jonathan like this that'll put the coat on David and say, here's the way you're supposed to act. Come on, give him a coat back. What's your deal already? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See my hand there? Now I see why you don't wear a coat to church. You don't know how to get it on. Lord always shows me somebody in revival that's got a good enough spirit I can tease him. And talking about loving each other. Worship has got to be love. Come on. I said, worship has got to be love. Have you ever stopped to think when that woman with the alabaster box came in that room and Simon the leper looked at her, he was criticizing her for worship, and he was in worse shape than she was. Come on. I'd rather be a sinner than somebody always whacking and pulling at the body of Christ. But she came to worship. She had that little box under her arm. Hallelujah. Come on. She might not. She probably wasn't dressed like the religious leaders thought she ought to be dressed. Come on. Her dress might have not have covered everywhere that they thought it ought to cover. Hallelujah. Hair might have not looked just right. Had one of them religious blouses on. Lo and behold, man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. You explain it to her, sis? Hallelujah. But she came in there and said, excuse me. Love has drawn me to this room. Come on, I've tried to find love. I've been looking for love in all the wrong places, and all I found was people that wanted to use me. Circumstances has used me up and chewed me up and spit me out, but I heard Jesus is in the house, and I've come with the alabaster box. No, you stay back. You're not. No, you excuse me. I'm going to get in His presence. Come on, you excuse me. I've come to worship. I love Him. Nobody had washed His feet. Nobody had anointed His hand. But she broke something to get on His in the presence of Jesus. You got to break some things. And when she broke that box, everything in the room began to change. The floor was different. The walls were different. Her dress was different. Her hair smelled different. Come on. God's got something He wants you to break in love before Him. And when you do, everything's going to be different. Come on. This needs to be a gossip, criticism-free zone where people can come in here and take off their helmet and not worry about somebody cracking them in the head. Come on. They're to be able to lay off their shield without somebody putting a knife in them. You may get cut, but it's not going to be cut from somebody in here because we're Christians and the spirit of love is a hold of us. I mean, we need to lay our swords against the wall. See, real worship is not just vertical. Real worship is horizontal and vertical. Come on. If you can't love me, your worship to God doesn't get any higher in your head. Come on. Come on. I told Jeff Arnold a while back, I said, Jeffy, God sent me and you to test the spirits of churches to see if they would love somebody like us. You got that right, Charlie. Can't say Charlie. Come on. What if God sends circumstances into your life to see if you're going to still love after all the tears and the hurt? Come on. He longs to come among us. God hungers to get in our presence. I say God longs to get in our presence. He longs to come upon us. But He will not produce Himself apart from Himself. Only God can beget God. Come on. See, love broke the box. Love forgives. Have you ever stopped to think about those 10 lepers that came to Jesus? He said, go show yourself to the priest. Go show yourself to the priest. 10 of them were healed, but one of them went to... Are you realizing what he was telling that man? I want you to go back to that old man of God that told you you've got a spot in your life that's going to kill you and separate you from your family. You go back to that old man of God. Come on. That guy came, he got up one morning and found a spot on his arm. You know what he thought? A spot. He looked at it, and that spot began to flake and get red. And you know what? He had to go show himself to the priest. And when he showed himself to the priest looked at it. And you know what? If we can get leprosy in a spirit and in the flesh, we can also, if we're not careful, leprosy can get in a house. And there's some stones that's got to be removed when leprosy gets in the house, or it's going to infect the whole house. Come on, is that Bible or not? Come on. You got to remove those stones. And that guy walked into the priest one day, and he said, go over here to this lattice work, this fence, and tell your wife goodbye, you can never touch your wife again. You can never put your arms around your kids again. You've got something in your life that's eating your life away. Come on. We want Pentecost to shout and hooping and hollering. It's like a buffet with nothing but whipped cream. Hallelujah. Come on. But there's some things that's got to be rooted out of our life. And God puts situations in our life to see if we've got enough love of God to keep on walking so we can be Antioch and he can call us Christians. You know what that man had to do? He had to go back to the man that pronounced the curse on him, the sin on him, and say, Reverend, I want you to set me free. And forgiveness is set free. Come on. Hallelujah. Not a whole lot of shouting and shucking and jiving and bucking going on in here tonight. Hallelujah. See, God wants to do something for us. And God is changing the church. The church needs to come home. The Father's waiting with open arms. The church wants us to be kind to the unkind. Come on. He wants us to love the unlovable. Our holiness repulses people. His holiness drew people because we do it and we're mad about doing it. I love God because he lets me live before him like I live before him. My holiness is not unto the UPC. Come on, I'm not living like this because I'm a member of the UPC. And I love the United Pentecostal Church. I've held a national office for 22 years. I hold three offices right now in our organization. But there's no virtue in the UPC. But it doesn't stand for underprivileged children either. It stands for you, Preacher Charlie. Hallelujah. See, love without holiness is nothing but spiritual control. Right teaching is the right kind of love. We've got to love like we've never loved before in our life. Authority without love does nothing but dominate. It never liberates. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm talking about they called them Christians. And God has allowed situations to come in your life individually and as the church here to see if you're going to love him in spite of everything. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was praying the other day and God just spoke to me on the airplane. And I read where Peter walked out in the Garden of Gethsemane and his two buddies, James and John, was over there checking their eyelids for cracks. Make some good saints. Come on. And all of a sudden, there's a rustle in the garden, and Peter wakes up, and they grab Jesus. He walks over there, reaches in, pulls that man's sword out. Take your hands off of him. Whap! Cut his ear off. I don't believe he got his head if he had to duck. But you know what? God spoke. Matthew never calls the name of the man that cut Malchus's ear off. Mark never calls the name. They just tell him. Luke never calls a name. But John names him. And I said, God, why did Matthew, Mark, and Luke never name it? But John names Peter as the one that cut Malchus's ear off. And they said, because Peter was alive when Matthew, Mark, and Luke wrote their gospel. And those men had a bond that they wouldn't hurt each other. They wouldn't bring an embarrassment against each other and pull a scab off of a wound. But when John wrote his, Peter had already been crucified upside down, and he wanted the church to know that you could still have the keys and be an apostle and still make mistakes in your life. Come on. I'm not convinced that the early church, and I appreciate all the outreach you're doing, and I'm praying an anointing on you. God's called you to it. But I'm not sure the early church had outreach on Saturday between 12 and 2. And they all got together and prayed over some tracts that they got from Jerusalem and went and passed them out. I think they had lifestyle evangelism. I think everywhere they went, the people saw the love of God in them. I think everywhere they went, there was something about them. I think they went by temple gates and blind men got up and lame men got up. And I think they went down here and people were healed. I think everywhere they went, there was such a love of God that they had to tell people about it. A lifestyle evangelism. Come on. a lifestyle evangelism. Everywhere you went, not Saturday from 2 to 4. Come on. But everywhere you went, everywhere you went, everywhere you went. Come on. Pray over your food out loud so people can hear you and somebody will say something. I read my Bible in the airport so people can come up and they'll come up and start talking to me. My wife washed it and faded, but I used to have a black T-shirt on the front of it had a picture of an Israeli fighter plane that said, "Don't worry, America, Israel's behind you." And I wear that. Come on. Brother Arnold, his young people all got a T-shirt, a sweatshirt, Brother Jeff Arnold, and they put their hand on that sweatshirt and drew an outline of their hand on that sweatshirt and signed their name, said, "We love you, Pastor Arnold." He was on a plane one day and wore that sweatshirt. Hallelujah. And the stewardess said, "What is that?" And he said, "I saved a bunch of kids from fire." "Really? How'd you do that?" He said, "I saved them from hell." Hallelujah. It don't take long to stoop and be kind. Come on. I was walking into a prison one day to preach, and I was walking down the hall going in to preach in the chapel, and the chaplain said, "Watch out, Chaplain Mahaney." And I stepped in blood. I had blood all over my shoe. And I was standing there trying to scrape that blood off my shoe, and I said, "What is that?" He said, "A man was just murdered here." I couldn't get the blood off my shoe. I kept trying to scrape the blood off my shoe. And I walked in, and the guy that just murdered the guy out there got the Holy Ghost. We baptized him in Jesus' name. Come on. I'm talking about a Christian. I'm talking about a Christian. I'm talking about a Christian. I'm not talking about 2 to 4 on Saturday or 7 o'clock on Wednesday night or Sunday at 6 o'clock when we come in here and I've got all of our little dues and we're all foxied up. I'm talking about a Christian out there on Sunday morning. Come on, I'm talking about a Christian on Monday when you go to the job. Come on, God put you in that job situation so you can shine as a Christian on that job. Hallelujah. Come on, God wants us to shine for Him. God wants us to shine for Him. I said, God wants us to shine for Him. God wants us to shine for Him. And I'm going to tell you the secret to the book of Acts revival, Acts 2, 2, second chapter of Acts, the 44th verse. "And all that believed were together and had all things common and sold their possession and goods and parted to them all, to all men, as every man had need. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added daily to the church such as should be saved." When they was Christians and everybody could see Him in them, the world fell into their hands like ripe fruit. They shared meals together. They faced crisis together. They shared their resources together. They met together. They grew together. They prayed together. Hallelujah. They had one to another fellowship. They loved one another. They cared for one another. They showed concern for one another. They prayed for one another. They served one another, helped one another, were patient with one another, and loved one another. I woke up about 4 months ago, and I was at San Diego, California, and I woke up, and I looked out across. I can see the ocean out here. I can see the ocean, and this way I can see San Diego or Tijuana, Mexico. And God woke me up out of a deep sleep, and I woke up praying, "God, I want you to anoint and bless my friend Irvin Baxter." Never called him, never told him. I just had such a burden for him about 4 months ago and said, "God bless my friend Irvin Baxter." Hallelujah. My wife was sick one night. She couldn't pray. I was gone. She was so sick she couldn't pray. And she had a vision of a little black woman getting down on her face and began to pray intercessory prayer, pray in tongues. And my wife had a vision of this. And a little bit my wife was healed and had never had another problem with that sickness. And when we was in Athens, Greece, they had a conference there, and a little black lady come up and told my wife the date and the moment that God laid it on her heart. And she got down and prayed intercessory prayer. Come on. Come on, I'm talking about Christians. I wish God would implant the cross in us. God.
Oh, God, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I wish God would implant the cross in us. Come on, the pain of leadership is getting people to follow us. Hallelujah. Moses sent 12, and then Joshua sent 2. They had to put their footprints in the burden that they felt. Come on. God wants a revival for us in these last days, and it's not going to come by organizational structure. Come on. Come on. I preached this last Saturday morning. Our general superintendent sitting right on the front row. And I said, they brought that ark back and they put it on that new cart and they put wheels and got a bunch of boards and put it together in wheels. And I said, God rejected it. This thing is not coming back with boards and big wheels. Brother Haney stood on his feet. He said, we got to have a revival. He said, we've accentuated education above the anointing. But he said, in my tenure, we're going to accentuate the anointing of God more than any education in the world. Because it's the anointing people feel. My wife and I walked out of a grocery store the other day, and a woman said, we walked up there, and she jumped. She said, you guys are Christians. I said, how do you know? She said, there's just something, an aura around you. Come on, that's where we got to get. And you know how it comes? You know how it comes? I had a bunch of stuff to pray for that day without spending 35, 40 minutes praying for Irvin Lee Baxter Jr. Come on. I needed to pray for my car that wasn't acting right. I needed to pray for some checks. We was praying to God I'd get an offering before the checks cleared the bank. Come on. My foot was hurting. My heel was hurting. I was up limping around praying, God, I want you to bless Irvin Baxter. Devil said, what about your foot? Well, if you don't get out of here, I'm going to put that foot against you. Hallelujah. Jeff would have said it. Hallelujah. See, love always gives itself away. Hallelujah. Oh, I feel the anointing of the God in here. Come on. They expected lights and kings and angels and thunder and chariots. Instead, they got sandals and sermons and a common man. He was so much like them, they missed him. Come on. God's love isn't human love. His love isn't normal. He sees your sin and he loves you anyway. He sees you at the darkest, dirtiest, filthy moment of your life and he said he loves you anyway. Being able to preach and sing and shout and being able to handle yourself in public is not the graduation diploma of the Spirit. Love is the graduation diploma of the Spirit. God doesn't give his love based on performance. We don't act and live to get his love. We do this because he loves us. If you never remember any statement I made in this revival, I want you to remember this statement. Real love always throws a party when the prodigal comes home. Come on, his love led him to 3 nails in a tree. Don't fall in love with his kingdom and not love the king. It's not people or circumstances that's got to change. We've got to change. Accepting the rejecting isn't weakness, it's love. You know what depression is? It's when we depress what God says we are to be what circumstances say we are. And that's the reason we're depressed. We're supposed to be the harvesters having worldwide revival, and other guys are riding our horses. Come on. I want love to come into this place. I want everybody here to feel a love like you've never come. He didn't come to build a monument. He came to start a movement. Jacob wrestled against his blessing. This church has been on the hit list of hell, but God has reached down and God's covered us with his shawl of love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kalalobokodabasata. I want some to pray in the Holy Ghost. Kalalaboriasata. Kalalobasata. Kalalalabasata. Come on, you're bleeding from so many wounds. Don't be embarrassed by your limp. Smile and cover up the scars and the bruises. Dilemmas have stretched you back and forth. Come on. Wherever and however the enemy has attacked you, it stops tonight. 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 Calvary was God's great plus sign. Calvary told the ages that I love you. Hallelujah. Come on. Calvary told the ages, here's how much I love you. They don't understand us all praying at the same time. They don't understand our shout and our worship sometimes. But when they come in here and feel this. I watched a visitor lady today while I was preaching on tithing leave this place and tears just running down her face. She felt something she couldn't explain. Come on, you know what it was? She didn't understand the tithing concept. She didn't understand it. But you know what? The world's not going to understand all of our precepts and all of our program and our protocol. But when they come in here and feel that love flowing from Calvary, and we can somehow touch Calvary, and our hands on Calvary, and our hands reached out to the world, they can feel something. Come on, lift your hands to Him and say, God, I've got to know You. Christians can be mean sometimes. I can't find this meanness and hardness in any part of Jesus. We're going to sing this chorus, but in closing, I want to take you to a Passover. Anybody ever been to a Jewish Passover, a Pesach, a Passover? There's a matzah and there's the four cups of wine. The first cup is a cup of blessing. The second cup is a cup of plagues. While he's reading the 10 plagues, he's pouring that cup out. The third cup is a cup of redemption. The fourth cup is the cup of Elijah, the cup of consummation. And we'll drink that with him under the chuppah when we get to heaven. As you look around that upper room, you see Peter, James, John. They're over there and they're arguing about the price of fish and the salt it takes to salt the fish to ship into the Roman Empire and how to hook a net. And they're on and on and on and on. And one woman comes up and said, could one of my boys sit on one hand and the other on the left hand? And as you look in that upper room, the youngest one in the place is in a position that makes him so obvious he's almost obnoxious. If you look closer, they're not sitting up in chairs, they're on the floor reclining. But if you look closer, the youngest one in the place, Yochanan, John, has his head on Jesus' bosom, saying, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. He don't care who gets to sit on the right hand or the left. He don't care about the price of fish or net. He's just saying, I love you, Jesus. And we all need a Judas. Listen to me. He called the ministry of Judas out just like he called John out. Everybody needs a Judas to push us to our crucifixion. We got to be crucified to be like him. And God puts a Judas. He called Judas. But John's over there got his head on his bosom. You say, so what? If you'll read Fox's, I think every Christian ought to read Fox's Book of Martyrs about once a year. Every one of those men died a horrible death. Except John. He found a place on the bosom of Jesus that day that the Roman Empire could not handle him. They tried to boil him in oil and couldn't kill him. They put him on Patmos, the Alcatraz of Antiquity, and he got the Book of Revelation. And you need to find that place on Jesus' bosom tonight and get your head, get the spirit of John in you, the beloved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They couldn't handle John because he never got his head off of Jesus. Hallelujah. Close your eyes and just reach your hands out to him and say, Jesus, I want to walk where I've never walked before. I want to get into waters I've never been in when it comes to the love. And oh, I feel an anointing on this place. I feel the arms of a shepherd just wrapping around us and pull us close to him, saying, I love you. I want to show you so many things. I feel a spirit of prophecy. God saying, I want to show you so many things, my children. I want to show you so many things, but I can. The only avenue I have is love. Hallelujah.